Hello and a big warm welcome to all of you watching online. My name is Hannah and I'm a curate here at St Mark's. And this morning we have Hennie, our vicar, who will be preaching. So some notices. Next week we have our guest speakers from Tear Fund sharing a video online with us. And so please do tune in for that. And we will be remaining online till the 2nd of December, but the church is open for prayer. So if you want to come in from 10 a.m. to 12, Monday to Friday, you can come in and just spend some time praying in the church building. Also, you may have received two emails from me, and you may have even seen a video. We have got something super exciting coming up at St Mark's Church, where we will be having a winter garden, and it's in collaboration with our local community, our schools, a college, and playgroups, and also you guys if you'd like to be. So please do check your emails, have a look at the video on the Facebook page and see how you can get involved. Finally, we also have a faith building project update, which is a video that we've also shared on our Facebook page, and Christine would have sent that out to you via email as well. So do have a look. It is super exciting with all of the things that have been going on behind the scenes in the last 6 months, and the church is transforming as we speak, and we are enlarging our tents. So let's just take a moment of silence as we prepare to come to our God. And so we all say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. So let's just take a moment to think on the week that we've had, the times when we have fallen short to God's desires for our lives, as we all do. And now we say together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed. Through negligence, through our own deliberate fault, we are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal and life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the collect for this morning. Heavenly Lord, you long for the world's salvation. Stir us from apathy, restrain us from excess, and revive us new hope that all creation will one day be healed in Jesus Christ our Lord. And now for our first hymn.
That you are our vision, that you are our king and you are our ruler over all. We pray this morning, Lord, that you will speak to us through the scriptures and that our hearts and minds will be open to receive all that you want to give to us today. In your name we pray. Amen. Can I add my welcome to Hannah's, to all of you who are watching this morning, wherever you might be. So we come to our final sermon in our series from Acts, and today's theme, for those who have been following, is the unimaginable to the miraculous. Thinking about how we cope when we find ourselves in situations that we never ever could have imagined ourselves to be in. For those who don't know the book of Acts, can I encourage you to read it? It's written by Luke, who also wrote the Gospel of Luke, and it tells of the birth of the church. And much of it tells us of the Apostle Paul's different journeys to places such as Athens, Corinth, Ephesus, where he spread the good news of the risen Christ, set up small places of worship, often getting into trouble, and often ending up in prison. And now, at the end of Acts, Paul, having got into even more trouble in Jerusalem and been brought before two Roman governors and King Agrippa, he is on his way to Rome by ship to stand before the great emperor himself, as a Jew and as a Roman citizen. He sets off from Caesarea with other prisoners under the care of a kind centurion called Julius and sails to Lycia, where they pick up another ship bound for Italy. And the weather was getting bad around the island of Crete, and Paul realized that it was too dangerous to carry on. He said, "I can see that the voyage will be with danger and much heavy loss, not only of the cargo and the ship, but also of our lives." But he was not listened to. And we take the story up from here, reading from Acts chapter 27, verses 18, to the end, from the Message translation, which is a bit shorter. "Next day, out on the high seas again, and badly damaged now by the storm, we dumped the cargo overboard. The third day, the sailors lightened the ship further by throwing off all the tackle and provisions. It had been many days since we had seen either sun or stars. Wind and waves were battering us unmercifully, and we lost all hope of rescue. With our appetite for both food and life long gone, Paul took his place in our midst and said, 'Friends, you really should have listened to me back in Crete. We could have avoided all this trouble and trial. But there's no need to dwell on that now. From now on, things are looking up. I can assure you that there will not be a single drowning among us, although I can't say as much for the ship. The ship itself is doomed. Last night, God's angel stood at my side, an angel of this God I serve, saying to me, 'Don't give up, Paul. You're going to stand before Caesar yet, and everyone sailing with you is also going to make it. So, dear friends, take heart. I believe God will do exactly what he told me. But we're going to shipwreck on some island or other. On the 14th night, adrift somewhere on the Adriatic Sea, at about midnight, the sailors sensed that we were approaching land. Sounding, they measured a depth of 120 feet, and shortly after that, 90 feet. Afraid that we were about to run aground, they threw out four anchors and prayed for daylight. Some of the sailors tried to jump ship. They let down the lifeboat, pretending they were going to set out more anchors from the bow. Paul saw through their guise and told the centurion and his soldiers, 'If these sailors don't stay with the ship, we're all going down.' So the soldiers cut the lines to the lifeboat and let it drift off. With dawn about to break, Paul called everyone together and proposed breakfast. 'This is the 14th day we've gone without food. None of us has felt like eating, but I urge you to eat something now, You'll need the strength for the rescue ahead. You're going to come out of this without even a scratch. He broke the bread, gave thanks to God, passed it around, and they all ate heartily. 276 of us. With the meal finished and everyone full, the ship was further lightened by dumping the grain overboard. At daybreak, no one recognised the land, but then they did notice a bay with a nice beach. They decided to try to run the ship up on the beach. They cut the anchors, loosed the tiller, raised the sail, and ran before the wind toward the beach. But we didn't make it. Still far from shore, we hit a reef, and the ship began to break up. The soldiers decided to kill the prisoners so none could escape by swimming. But the centurion, determined to save Paul, stopped them. He gave orders for everyone who could swim to dive in and go for it, and for the rest to grab a plank. Everyone made it to the shore safely. This is a story of life and death. This is a story of doing the opposite of what one would imagine was the right thing to do. Who could blame the sailors trying to escape in their lifeboat? But Paul said, unless these men stay in the ship, they cannot be saved. This is a story of salvation. All are saved. They land on the island of Malta, where they are well received, fed, and clothed. And this goes on into chapter 28. Paul is thought of as a god. He survives a snake bite, heals the sick, and eventually arrives in Rome, where he is allowed to live by himself under guard. Read this chapter for yourselves, where you'll find Paul thanking God and with great courage teaching the good news of the risen Jesus Christ and proclaiming the kingdom of God to all who had ears to hear and eyes to see. And he did this with boldness and without hindrance. Chapter 27, the unimaginable. Chapter 28, perhaps the miraculous. There's a story behind this cartoon. This is Hagar the Horrible. His ship has been shipwrecked and is going down. And he's standing on a rock shouting out to God, "Why me?" And God responds, "Why not?" This cartoon sits on the desk of Joe Biden. He was given it by his father after he lost his first wife and baby daughter in a car crash, and where his two young sons were also badly injured, but survived. And one of the sons went on to get cancer and died aged 40. He said his father was worried that he would lose his faith after this terrible tragedy, and that he wanted him to realize that God never said terrible things wouldn't happen to those who put their trust in Jesus. In fact, for those of us who have chosen to follow Jesus, we are told to pick up our crosses each day, reminding ourselves of what Christ has done for us on the cross at Calvary, and the hope of the resurrection 3 days later, which we celebrate on Easter Day. I think sometimes we forget that our lives should be cruciform in shape, the same as Christ's. Paul says in Romans 8, "We also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been
poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. I could imagine there must have been many times when Paul might have wanted to cry out, "Why me?" As he faced trials, tribulations, beatings, shipwrecks, and imprisonment. I'm sure there have been times for those who are listening to this talk when you might have called out, "Why me, God?" Perhaps you are in the midst of a metaphorical shipwreck at this present time, or have been in the past, or can see one coming up in the not too distant future. I can remember many years ago saying to Ruth, my dear friend and a Christian counsellor, "Life is so unfair." And she just responded, "Yes, it is." That's not what I wanted to hear, but so true. Why me? Why not? Says God. For many, these past 8 months must have been like living in a storm, and for some, their lives may appear to have been shipwrecked. Your lives, those who are listening. What can we learn from Paul as to how to survive when our lives are being torn apart by the violent storms that we might find ourselves in? The things that I picked out from this shipwreck story is that, one, Paul was a man of prayer. Prayer is not just talking to God, but listening as well. He was alert to God's voice even when the ship was being torn apart and they were in a place of great darkness. It had been many days since we had seen either sun or stars. And he recognized God's voice. "Last night, God's angel stood at my side, an angel of this God I serve, saying to me, 'Don't give up, Paul.'" Two, Paul had a personal relationship with Jesus. In the NRSV translation, it says, "An angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I worship said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand before the emperor.'" Paul knew to whom he belonged. He was a child of God. And it was to him only whom he worshipped, even when things were not looking good for him. He was still going to have to stand before the Roman emperor, who could sentence him to immediate death on arrival in Rome. Three, Paul was a man of courage. He was told not to be afraid, but to have courage. Some of us on the leadership team have signed up to something called Church Next, run by Lead Academy, helping us to look forward and engage with how the church might look as we come out of this extraordinary time. Courage is a word that is being spoken of. Leaders need courage if they are to do things that God might be asking of them, but might rather not do. Fear can paralyze us from moving on and out of a storm or shipwreck. It was fear that made the sailors jump overboard, but courage was needed to stay on the sinking ship. Five, Paul had implicit trust in God, even though it didn't look great ahead. "Dear friends, take heart. I believe, or I have faith in God, that he will do exactly what he told me. Yes, we are going to be shipwrecked on some island, but we will be saved." Six, Paul had a thankful heart. He broke the bread and gave thanks to God. We have a picture of the body of Jesus being broken and distributed. Paul said to all on board, "I urge you to take some food, for it will help you survive."
for none of you will lose a hair on your head. In this storm and shipwreck, Paul holds on to Jesus, the one who saves, the one who met him on the road to Damascus, who saved him and gave him a new calling and a new vocation. This week, I was on a Zoom meeting with some other clergy in the diocese and with our new Bishop of Chester. And he was asked what it was like coming into this diocese at this time. And he said it felt like being in a great storm with all that was going on. And he said, in a storm or shipwreck, you must refuse to let go of Jesus. And you must refuse to let go of where you know Jesus has called you, even though you might prefer to be elsewhere. I felt that was quite helpful. So perhaps if you are going through a stormy time at the moment, don't think that is not where Jesus wants you to be, hard as though that might be. And if you feel your life has been shipwrecked, and there will be many reasons why, if you know Jesus, don't allow yourselves to be wrenched apart from him. Even in the storm, we can give thanks because we have Jesus with us. And he has been through the shipwrecks of all shipwrecks, if you like. He knows what it is like to be in darkness. But through that comes a new dawn, a new light, a new life, and resurrection hope. I want to tell another story, which I think gives us another picture of the unimaginable to the miraculous. The last hymn that Nina has chosen to play is "It Is Well With My Soul." And she was reminding me of the story behind the hymn. It's an amazing one, and I dug a little deeper. The hymn was written by Horatio Spafford, a very committed Christian, in 1873. He had lost his business in the Great Chicago Fire, and so he sent his wife Anna and four young daughters off to Paris by ship to make a new life, with the intention of joining them shortly. However, the ship they were on, 4 weeks into the journey, collided with a Scottish tanker called the Lache, which is a loch very near to where my mother lives. The ship went down, and all four children were drowned. Anna survived, being found drifting on a piece of timber in the ocean. And she was rescued and taken to Wales. She sent her husband a telegram saying, "Saved alone, what shall I do?" Horatio set sail soon after for England to meet up with Anna. And when the ship was sailing over the place where his girls had drowned, the captain called him and showed him. And as he looked out in deep grief, he felt the words well up inside him. "It is well with my soul." He knew his girls were with Jesus. And rather than allowing fear and despair to overwhelm him, he sensed a deep peace and knew the hope that does not disappoint us. He and Anna returned to Chicago and had another little boy and girl, but the boy died very shortly after he was born from scarlet fever. They went on to have another girl. So out of seven children, only two daughters survived, Bertha and Grace. In 1881, they moved to Jerusalem and opened a home for children. Horatio died 7 years later, but Anna and their two daughters continued with the work that they felt God had called them to. One could look at this story as a life shipwrecked by grief, but Horatio and Anna were a couple steeped in prayer, knowing who they were in the family of God, believing that God had another calling on their lives, had huge courage, implicit trust in God, and went on to do what they did with thankful hearts. I'm not saying these are easy things to do when we find ourselves in unimaginable places of grief, fear, unemployment, overwhelmed by debt and poverty, severe illness, disability, mental health, family, marriage breakdown, breakdown of relationships, whatever other situation seems to be shipwrecking our lives. We know from Paul himself that at times he would rather die than go through what he had to go through. But we also know that because he knew he had been saved by Jesus and called to witness the resurrection of Jesus to Jews and Gentiles, he was ready to endure all things. In Philippians, he says, "For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things." And goes on, "I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead." May I suggest that Paul's life was cruciform in shape, shaped by the cross and life of Jesus Christ. For me, the miraculous is the gift of new life. Jesus came so that we may have life and life in all its fullness. And that doesn't mean eliminating all suffering in our lives. Rather, it means living our lives as if we belong to Jesus, and whatever our circumstances, be obedient to his call on our lives. I leave you with Tom Wright's final word on this chapter. He says, "There are many Christians who have been taught that once they have faith, everything ought to flow smoothly. Acts 27 replies, "You have not yet considered what it means to take up the cross. If the gospel of Jesus means anything at all, it means that those who carry it will have it branded into their own souls." We too then might be able to echo the words of Horatio Stafford: "It is well with my soul." Amen.
Thank you, Hennie, for such a thought-provoking sermon. And so, in this time, we come to a time of prayer, and let us come in our grief, our sorrow, our joy, and our excitement, and everything in between. And so the response to the prayer in this time is, "Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer." In peace, let us pray to Jesus, our Lord, who ever lives to make intercession for us. Saviour of the world, be present in all places of suffering, violence, and pain, and bring hope even in the darkest night. Inspire us to continue your work of reconciliation today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of the Church, empower by your Spirit all Christian people and the work of your Church in every land. Give us grace to proclaim the gospel joyfully in words and deeds. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Shepherd and guardian of our souls, guide and enable all who lead and serve this community and those on whom we depend for our daily needs. Grant that we may seek the peace and welfare of this place. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Great physician, stretch out your hand to bring comfort, wholeness, and peace. We continue to pray for Hennie's sister Lucy and also the Percy family, and for all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Fill us with compassion that we may be channels of your healing love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Conqueror of death, remember for good those whom we love but see no longer. Help us to live this day in the sure and certain hope of your eternal victory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Amen. And so we will have our second hymn.
Oh,
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of God.